Tonight's Major League Roller Hockey event is brought to you by Mission Hockey, proud sponsor of RollerHockeyTV.net. Visit their websites at missionhockey.com and check out their fine products.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are live from Novi, Michigan, and this is Major League Roller Hockey as we bring RollerHockeyTV.net tonight. Very exciting lineup. This man to my left needs no introduction. The one and only Santa Claus is here live in person at halftime tonight. He'll be taking shots from all the good little boys and girls who are hoping to beat him and receive a Christmas prize. And Santa, how do you feel about that?
Nobody beats Santa Claus.
Well, we'll find out tonight if anybody can score on Santa Claus. But other than that, this evening we have a doubleheader. You'll be watching the Chicago Carnage and the Motor City Assault as they take action with each other. And then immediately following that game, we bring you the Buffalo Excitement as they will be taking on the New York Rockers for the Battle of New York. A very exciting evening planned here, but let's talk a little bit about the Chicago Carnage. The Carnage has been here this afternoon. Kenny Van Sky doing a great job in bringing a team out here to Novi, Michigan. They fared well, playing in their first game with a big win. Second game, unfortunately, being a little lopsided in a loss. But the team has been a little decimated by injuries. Several players, two players actually to be correct, were injured during their first game. So Kenny's bench strength has somewhat dropped. We'll be joining that game momentarily. But let's talk about the Motor City Assault. Very exciting game this afternoon. Even Santa, what would you say about that game?
Ho, ho.
He's in the Christmas mood and spirit as a Motor City Assault and the Buffalo Excitement played to a 4-3 overtime victory. If you weren't there, it was a fantastic game. Fans in the building glued to their seats, standing up, yelling and screaming. And this place tonight is packed. We've got about 150 to almost 200 people here to watch Major League Roller Hockey. And it's an exciting evening. We're going to take a moment to pause for a commercial break with our very important sponsor, Santa. Anything to add?
Ho, ho, ho.
He's a man of few words, but boy, we know he gets the job done. We'll be right back on Roller Hockey TV Net after these commercial messages. Hey, my man, thank you. Or do you want to go to the play? You tell me. Huh? Alright, let me get the play-by-play mic.
The Axiom T10 Revolt, featuring a true vented tongue and an anti-sting lace bite insert. With airflow like this, your feet will always stay dry.
Dude, why'd you stop? T10s are dry.
I don't think they're dry.
Come check out the Axiom T10 Revolt for yourself at the NARCS 2011 Finals.
And we are live here in Novi, Michigan at Total Roller Hockey. What an amazing facility here. As the Motor City Assault, Chicago Carnage, and there's a goal for the Motor City Assault as Brandon Dare broke down the wing. He wasn't tested by the defenseman, rips off a snapshot, and it's a 1-1 hockey game. In case you haven't been here, ladies and gentlemen, right now the Motor City Assault and the Chicago Carnage are locked into a 2-1 hockey game. Carnage having a little bit of difficulty, as I said, due to their short bench and injury, but the Motor City Assault and Brandon Dare riding the lamp there to make it 2-1. We're going to continue with the live play as we take a look. Motor City Assault will now control the puck, head back into their end as Captain Brandon Jeanette will now move it up to the boards. Jeanette looking for some room and real estate at center as he'll control the puck. And now number 9, Kyle Strombowski, will handle the puck. Strombowski behind his own net. Motor City Assault looking to make something happen as they try to regroup in their own end. And as they do so, some of the players go for a line change. Here's Strombowski again as he rushes down the middle. Nice into outside move. And the referee there is going to make a penalty call. He's going to give Strombowski 2 minutes for unsportsmanlike conduct for putting the top of his stick blade on the puck and pulling it through his legs. Strombowski not happy with the call. He's going to argue with the official on his way to the box, but there's no way that referee is going to wave that call off. Referee standing firm and still, insisting on it. Meanwhile, Captain Brandon Jeanette now pleading his case on the call as we watch here, and the Motor City Assault players are not happy with that call. Well, Santa Claus was here earlier. There are no Christmas presents here in Novi, Michigan, ladies and gentlemen, and they're not going to talk their way out of that one. So, at this time, we're looking at a penalty call. We're going to use this opportunity to take a commercial break here. You are watching the Motor City Assault and the Chicago Carnage live on RollerHockeyTV.net.
DJ Khaled! Hey! Yeah! All I do is win, 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 no matter what. Got money on my mind, I can never get enough. And every time I step up in the building, everybody hands go up. And they stay there.
Won't stop now. Whoa. Keep your hands up, get them in.
Break. Brandon Dare has just scored a natural hat trick to make it 3-1 with a short-handed goal on the Chicago Carnage. Dare coming down on a 2-on-1 took a great pass as it was slid over to him by Brandon Jeanette and buried the puck short side on the goaltender for Chicago, and fatigue is starting to set in. You really have to feel for the Carnage players as this is their third game of the day, and like I said, that shortened bench certainly has not helped them at all. They've worked very hard, very diligent to get themselves into this game. And being on the power play right now, they've got a minute 26 left on the power play, and they're down 3-1. So let's see if the Carnage can make something happen as they line up for the faceoff at center. Again, Brandon Dare completing the natural hat trick to make it 3-1 for the Motor City Assault. Now here's the Assault with control of the puck again. They are shorthanded. Brandon Dare flips it through the middle. Carnage now gets control. They're going to look to set up, trying to make something happen. They're going to slow down the pace of the game. Here's the Carnage moving the puck. As they do, it goes to the top to the point man. As number 81, Dave Hines, will hold on to it. The puck is stripped away from him and taken by Josh Jakobsen, who will move it back. And once again, Motor City Assault goes into that protective power play kill as they do so well on the penalty kill. Chicago players all having to touch up on the red line. If you remember, the MLRH rules are anytime the defending team clears the puck, that the team on the offensive attack must touch up at the red line and get back into the zone. This prohibits the cherry picking. as we're deep again. Chicago trying to make something happen as they move the puck behind the net. And once again, they'll maintain control. Bad pass made by Will Quinn as Joe Quinn goes back for the puck. As he now gathers control, once again, Chicago has touched up on the red line. There's an offside pass, but smart play by the Carnage player not to touch it because it would result in an offside violation. Ronnie Green there using his head, knowing that if he touched that puck, there would be an immediate whistle. So what does Ronnie do? He decides not to touch it and then allows number 87, Jason Jokinen, to touch the puck, and we get a whistle, and the play goes to outside of the zone. And the face-off between Motor City and Chicago, 3-1. Your Motor City assault is on top as they are now back to even strength. It's 4-on-4 hockey, ladies and gentlemen. Here's Colin Sipperly with the puck trying to make some magic happen behind the net, but he's stripped, and Chicago once again maintains control. Nice play as they make a breakout pass up, and unfortunately is a little bit too hot for number 8, Ronnie Green, to handle. Puck will trickle back to center, and here's Sipperly again. On the rush, Sipperly looking for an open teammate. Makes a nice move to the middle. Snapshot. Great save by the goaltender for the Carnage as he kicks that puck right out. Jim Thompson, who's faced a lot of rubber tonight. They should call him the Michelin Man. He kicks that puck right out, and we're heading back as, once again, the Motor City Assault is on the attack. Number 87, Jason Jokinen, will break into the zone, and they decide to regroup. As the team regroups, they get a line change, get some fresh legs. Chicago wishing to be in that situation, but unfortunately tonight, they don't have that luxury. Great pass through as Brandon Dare tried to thread the needle for number 13, Kyle Sipperly, brother of Colin. The Sipperly brothers in full action tonight here. And again, some nice puck movement as a Motor City Assault tries to get a shot onto net. Once again, that trickles wide. And right now, Chicago fatigued as it looks like we have an icing here. The referee will wave off the icing as he felt that one of the defensemen for the Motor City Assault could have played it. As we continue, great hit and thunder hit in the corner as the puck moves back into the Chicago zone. Chicago maintaining control as number 9 will take it. That's Brian Berman, who then rotates the puck over to his defensive partner, number 17, Rob Quinn. Quinn with the puck, and it's a turnover deep in the zone. Motor City Assault, backhand goes wide. He's a little bit too far out there to take that backhand shot. And again, right now, fatigue setting in as a goaltender. What a save by Jim Thompson. Comes out and shuts down the Motor City Assault player. Here's Brandon Dare with the hat trick, with the puck, moving it around as a Motor City Assault. There's a giveaway. Here comes the Carnage now. They've got a breakaway. If they get the puck up to the player, there's a shot. Rebound. Oh, it kicked right back out. And I thought the Carnage were going to light the lamp there. Great save by the goaltender for Motor City as Mark Meyer, who's wearing number 7 and in goal, stood up, played a great angle shot, and nice pick and move play as once again, here comes the Carnage on attack. Number 77, number 8, shot. Big save by Mark Meyer once again as number 96 for the Carnage. Nick Silk was trying to get control of it. There's another shot and another save by Meyer. Meyer coming up huge right now as he made 2 point blank saves on shots by both Nick Silk and Eric Newell out there, working hard and diligent. Once again, here's Jason Jokinen with the puck as he cuts down. Nice inside-outside move. Trying to walk in on a defenseman. Doesn't have any real estate. Can't really set the play. And we're going to slow things down. Now, Chicago playing it smart. They want to take the opportunity. Again, bench short. They want to slow the pace down in the game a little bit. Get that puck over the red line. Great move there as number 77, Matt Brown, just deked out the defenseman, trickled it in on front, and Matt Brown scores to make it 3-2 on a great passing play as he cut across that line, set a nice pick and move, dropped the puck off to his teammate, who in fact made a great saucer pass to him in front of the net. And you have to give credit to number 81, Dave Hines. That was a great play by Hines as he waited for the defenseman to commit to him and then trickled the puck right over, and now we've got ourselves a 3-2 game with 3:57 to go in the first half. If you've just tuned in, you're watching RollerHockeyTV.net. Exciting evening tonight. Santa Claus is in the building, and we've got some great promotion coming on at halftime as Santa will be taking shots from the little kids out here. Right now, it's the Motor City Assault up, 3-2, and what a save by goaltender Jim Thompson for the Chicago Carnage, keeping them in the game. Thompson coming up again. What a save. Comes out, cuts the angle down, takes away that shot. We're going to use this opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to pause for commercial break. You are watching the RollerHockeyTV.net network live from Novi. Ladies and gentlemen, back here, 3-2 lead for the Motor City Assault on top of the Chicago Carnage here in Novi, Michigan, December 3rd. And this facility that we've been at today, got to spend some time with Jim Gorney, who runs everything here, an absolute terrific guy, gave us a tour. They have a full-size rink and a mini rink that the kids practice on. And momentarily, at the end of this half, we're going to be watching Santa Claus come out here and letting the kids shoot on him at halftime. There's our hooking call made by our official, as there's a nice in-and-out pass there, and the Carnage are going to be shorthanded for 2 minutes to finish out this period there. That's what happens when you get a little bit fatigued, and you really can't blame the Carnage players, because right now fatigue is setting in. So what happens is, because of the short bench, moving your legs isn't as easy as it was in the first couple games that you played today. So fatigue being a factor in that hooking penalty. With that happening, the Motor City Assault is now on the power play. They're going to regroup in their end, and you're using the box here, setting up on my left. If you look, Brandon Dare with the puck coming down low. Nice pass, spinoff. Unfortunately, that puck couldn't be handled, and we've got a breakaway for number 8 of the Carnage. And there's a good call by the referee, because that pass was over the red line. In Major League Roller Hockey, the puck cannot be passed to any player over the red line. So he made the right call. That's a good call by the referee. Again, the puck cannot be passed over the red line. So we're very glad to see the referees here at Novi are in tune that nobody can pick up a pass like that and carry it in. We thought we'd have a breakaway, and once again, Brandon Dale with the puck. It's going to go over to number 68 to Jared Jokumson. Jokumson with the shot. What a save by the goaltender once again. And I tell you, Jim Thompson deserves a lot of credit right now, as he's been facing a lot of rubber. With less than 10 seconds to play in the half, we're going to look like we're going to finish out 3-2 here, unless they score a last minute goal, as once again Brandon Dale with the puck scores! Up to the referees whether or not that one's going to count. The referee says yes, that is good. So we're going to finish our period with a score of 4-2 as the Motor City Assault score on the power play. You're watching Major League Roller Hockey live on RollerHockeyTV.net. We're going to pause for commercial break, and we're going to come back to Santa Claus being live on the rink, as he's going to have some holiday shooters that are here especially for him. We'll be right back after these commercial messages.
This is Georgie Barber of AKS Mission Empire. He's really good. And this is the Hornet Split. Is there a doctor in the building? I'm definitely having a seizure right now. No, seriously, call one. The Hornet Split's going to grip better and last longer using our patented M-Tech technology. What's a dog doing in the video? Weird. Don't believe me? Ask AKS Mission Empire, NARCH Division 1 champions. Get on the Hornet Split today, because you do not want to make this guy mad.
We are live here as Santa Claus is now on the rink. He's decided to put on the goalie gear, and each youngster is going to get a shot on Santa. Here comes our first shooter. He deeks. He shoots. He scores! Santa Claus, not too happy, which means that youngster is going to take home a prize. I tell you, Santa comes up short, and he's just questioning what happened on that one. He's not happy. Here comes our second shooter. As he comes down, he's going to take a look. He's going to deke Santa Claus. He walks in. Santa trying to take... Oh, he beats him upstairs. Santa Claus, again, a little frustrated. As I think it's a little chilly up in the North Pole, he takes a whack at the goalpost. Here comes our third shooter with skates on. Oh, he's got some momentum, folks. Nice move to the outside. He scores! Santa Claus. Oh, that red light is starting to affect him. I don't think he's too happy on here right now. Ladies and gentlemen, he's a little frustrated. Here comes our fourth shooter. Look at this guy go. Kicks the puck to himself. Walks in. Shot. He scores! As he beats Santa Claus, and Santa hasn't stopped one puck yet. We heard him say it earlier. Nobody scores on Santa. Well, I think it's just the opposite. Everybody scores on Santa Claus. And here comes the young lady doing her best, trying to come down the rink here. As she goes, she keeps going. Oh! Just lost the puck. She's got it. She's got to keep going. She's going to walk in on Santa. Santa trying to stop her. Oh, strike one. Here comes. Shot. And a goal. She scored on Santa Claus. Oh, and here comes our final shooter. Looks like our final shooter is coming down at this time. We got one more. And here he is. The last attempt on Santa Claus. We're going to have Santa in the studio to find out what happened to him. Oh, this guy's just playing with Santa Claus. That's not right. Oh, he hits the post. And there's no goal. What a great job. We're going to be right back on the Roller Hockey TV Network after these commercial messages. Santa Claus lets in 5 out of 6 goals.
Axiom T10 Revolt, featuring a true vented tongue and an anti-sting lace bite insert. With airflow like this, your feet will always stay dry.
Dude, why'd you stop? T10s are dry.
I don't think they're dry yet.
Come check out the Axiom T10 Revolt for yourself at the NARCS 2011 Finals.
I'm back here live in the studio, Doug Jones with one and only Santa Claus. And as we know today, Christmas very shortly. And kind of a sad thing in our country that we have to say holidays, happy holidays. I say Christmas. I always will say Christmas. Merry Christmas, happy holidays. Santa Claus, you've got to feel very emotional after a performance like that. Six shooters, five goals, one save. What do you have to say?
Open sieve.
Open sieve. Well, I'll tell you what, Christmas came early tonight for several of our participants. Every child on the floor got a rocket puck. Rocket puck is the official hockey puck of Major League Roller Hockey, and we're very proud to have their company as a sponsor. Santa Claus came in all the way from the North Pole. Santa, I want to thank you for coming out tonight.
Thanks, man.
Any comments for our viewers? Christmas is coming up. Any reminders for the kids? Cookies and milk?
You better be good, and you better have my cookies ready.
Better be good, better have his cookies ready. And just remember, you saw it on rollerhockeytv.net. Santa Claus said he wouldn't let a goal in, and we saw five out of six goal performance by Santa Claus tonight. Santa, good luck. Welcome back to the North Pole. We'll be right back on rollerhockeytv.net after these commercial messages.
They stay there, and they say yeah, and they stay there. Cause all I do is win, win, win. And if you going in, put your hands in the air, make them stay there.
Ludacris going in on the verse, cause I've never been defeated and I won't stop now. Keep your hands up, get them in.
Check, one, two, touch.
Joining our game as we're in the second half right now, 4-2, the Motor City Assault with that late power play goal. That's Chicago Carnage right now. Great move inside, outside. Takes that snapshot, but unfortunately, goaltender Mark Meyer comes up huge for the Motor City Assault. A great move there by Brian Berman, showing a lot of guts as he was tired as goaltender Joe Thompson for the Chicago Carnage now poke checks a loose puck away, and it'll trickle back to center. Here's a Motor City Assault, number 22, trying to maintain control. That's Andrew James as he'll dump it in deep. And the puck will now head into the corner, and it's blocked by a defenseman, Nick Silk, number 96 of the Chicago Carnage. Here's an offside pass. Great call again by the officials here. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, in Major League Roller Hockey, that puck cannot be passed across the red line. It must be carried. Anytime a player makes a pass across the red line, we'll immediately have a whistle and a face-off from where the pass came from. So our officials tonight in Novi, Michigan, doing a fantastic job. Once again, if you haven't been here to Total Roller Hockey, it's hosted great events like NARCH has had their qualifiers here. We've also seen, I believe, a Tours qualifier. And Jim Gorney has done some great things with the youth program. So we congratulate him on his hard work and watching it pay off. As again, we've got a little bit of a battle in front of the net. Once again, Chicago Carnage goaltender Jim Thompson coming up big and making another big save for his teammates. Thompson having a great afternoon as he's faced a lot of shots. I know I said it earlier. I know I'm repeating myself, but you have to give Jim Thompson credit back there. He's really kept the carnage in this game and done a great job. And not that it's the teammates' fault. Again, that third game, the fatigue coming in, the players are feeling it. As the Motor City Assault will now take control of the puck, and here we go for the carnage. Carnage coming up on an outside attack as Colin Sipperly will knock the puck away as Ronnie Green there tried to make a valiant move. Green was still a little bit upset at the end of the first half after that pass that he took for a breakaway. But again, you cannot pass the puck across the line in Major League Roller Hockey. Sipperly again with another great play as he upends and knocks over Will Quinn. Quinn now looking for the puck. Here's a carnage again, maintaining control. Nice pass in front. Deep down left shot. Number 9, Brian Berman tried to unleash that shot. And goaltender Mark Meyer comes up huge to task once again. Meyer also playing a great game. I know the score is 4-2, but both these goaltenders have equally played an outstanding game this evening in Novi, Michigan. Puck's loose in front. And once again, we've got another big save as Joe Thompson comes up with the puck, and we'll have a face-off to the outside. And excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, it's a goal. They're going to call that a goal, as it looks like the Motor City Assault player. We'll find out who scored that momentarily. Player came into the crease area and knocked in the loose puck. And once again, experience here of the Motor City Assault is starting to carry into this game just a little bit. But the Carnage, like I said, with a short bench, very courageous team here, continuing to work hard. They're not quitting. They're not dropping the heads. What a great pass. Oh, what a move as he tried to pull that puck back. And Robbie Green was in all alone, but he just could not get that puck to lay flat for him, and he lost control of it. Motor City Assault will return on the attack as Jared Jokubisen, if I mispronounce your name, Jared, I apologize, takes a slash to one of the Carnage players, hits him pretty hard, and there's no call there. As the Carnage now is going to regroup and try and slow the pace down, very smart move. Coach Kenny Van Skye on the bench, I think, doing a great job by making sure his players are trying to slow this pace down. Rocket puck there, rolling just a little bit. As you know, rocket puck is the official puck of Major League Roller Hockey. Carnage player giving it up at the blue line, and Kyle Stabarsky comes in. Shot, and he'll bury the puck on a breakaway as he beats the goaltender short side low to make it 6-2. And right now, the Motor City Assault, again, is beginning to run away with this game. So as we take a look, ladies and gentlemen, the score is 6-2, as we just saw a great move and another great goal. And a 6-2 lead for the Motor City Assault as Ronnie Green will return the action and put a shot on goal. We're going to use this whistle, an opportunity for a stoppage in play, to once again promote our proud sponsors of Major League Roller Hockey. We'll be right back on the RollerHockeyTV.net network after this commercial message. Welcome back to Novi, Michigan, as we're in the second half of the game. Motor City Assault up 6 over the Chicago Carnage, who are down by a 4-goal lead right now. Carnage, who again, and as I've said, are a little bit fatigued this evening after playing 3 games and having some injuries that have decimated their bench size. But Coach Kenny Van Skye doing the best he can. And I'll tell you what, these Carnage players, they got a lot of guts. They came out here their first game this afternoon. They beat a very, very good team as they walked in and won their first game 4-1 over the New York Rockers. That was a great game to watch if you were here. And now the Carnage just showing the effects of a little too much hockey. But that doesn't mean the night's over for them. 8:40 left in the game. This is the second half as we have a face-off to the left of goaltender Mark Meyer, who's done a fantastic job. And the Motor City Assault will plow that puck ahead. There they go. Great breakout pass as Jared Jokubisen, and again, I apologize if I mispronounce his name, will leave that puck in the middle as Brandon Jeanette will play hot potato. I don't want it. You can have it. You touch it. Colin Sipperly now will control the puck in his own end. And there's a great play by Ronnie Green of the Carnage to break up that pass. Here's Sipperly. ladies and gentlemen, leaves the puck back. And once again, Jared Jokubisen, dangerous pass through the middle. Don't know what he was thinking there. Throws it through and it doesn't get picked off. And it goes deep into the Carnage zone. Once again, as number 9, Kyle Strombowski will take the shot from a very bad angle. And there we got a clean breakaway pass. Ronnie Green is in. Shoots. Big save once again by Mark Meyer as he comes out, cuts down the angle, uses that glove to his advantage, and boy, did he pick that shot up out of midair. Great play by the goaltender. And once again, the fatigue setting in is Jim Thompson for the Carnage, and I don't blame him. Every time he touches that puck, he wants to hold on to it and get a whistle. And we're going to use that opportunity again to proudly promote the sponsors of Major League Roller Hockey. We'll be right back on the RollerHockeyTV.net network after these commercial messages.
This is Georgie Barber of AKS Mission Empire. He's really good. And this is the Hornet Split. Is there a doctor in the building? I'm definitely having a seizure right now. No, seriously, call one. The Hornet Split's going to grip better and last longer using our patented M-Tech technology. What's a dog doing in the video? Weird. Don't believe me? Ask AKS Mission Empire, NARCH Division 1 champions. Get on the Hornet Split today because you do not want to make this guy mad.
Just a reminder, next weekend, Major League Roller Hockey returns to Irvine as we have a spectacular lineup for everybody. Rob Lurie of the, Anaheim Bullfrogs will have his number one retired in a pregame ceremony, and then the Anaheim Bullfrogs will take on the Arizona Arsenal. Last time they played, the Arsenal beat the Bullfrogs 5-4, scoring an empty net goal. They'll be the feature first game of the night. And then the second game of the evening, Joaquin Chabrera returns to Major League Roller Hockey as he and the Hollywood Dream will be taking on the undefeated and top of the proverbial mountain champion, Mission Axiom, our 2011 champions and winner of $10,000. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. People on the East Coast and the West Coast are competing for that $10,000 purse that comes out to everybody as the Chicago Carnage will take control of the puck and they're on the power play. Carnage now, again, like I said, little fatigue sets in, so they're going to play, and looks like we might have a high sticking call, and we will. Player play the puck with a high stick, so that faceoff will go all the way down into the defensive zone. Not a good thing to do when you're on the power play, but like I said, when the oxygen level in the brain starts to get a little lower, it's hard to make those quick decisions without maybe having your reflexes take over and act. Face-off in the defensive zone to the right of Jim Thompson, who's done a great job again for the Carnage. Even though he's let in 6 goals, you can't blame Jim for a majority of those goals because, again, his teammates have been fatigued. With that, we get an offside pass as the shorthanded Motor City Assault moved the puck over the red line and was received by number 97, Tony Asenzo, who was whistled offside. And now the Carnage will get some prime real estate for their faceoff as they try to get control of the puck. Let's see if they... Oh, great move by the defenseman, but he made one too many moves there. And that was a great job by number 96, Nick Silk. He went inside, outside. That puck gets picked off by Brandon Dare. He'll go down almost coast-to-coast, roof it over a very tired Jim Thompson to make it a 7-2 hockey game. So with 4 minutes and 11 seconds... We've seen our second shorthanded goal of the day as a Motor City Assault jump out on top of the Chicago Carnage 7-2. 16 seconds left on the power play as the Carnage are trying to make something happen. Guys are so tired. It was great this afternoon, the first games of the day. We saw hits galore. It was like a buffet of hits. Everybody was hitting each other. Now that the teams have played their third game, the fatigue sets in. You see the guys playing more of a skilled hockey game rather than worrying about the body contact. That being said, our faceoff is in the defensive zone of the Motor City Assault, as Ronnie Green maintains control. Ronnie fighting his teammate for the puck, makes a nice behind-the-back pass as they both go into the corner and fight for it. And once again, Brian Berman will move it back to his defenseman. Great move there as number 81, Dave Hines, walks the puck in, tries to get a shot from a bad angle, and Mark Meyer is sturdy to the task as he kicks that out. Nice breakout pass as number 87, Jared Wilkomason, could not handle it, and I apologize once again if I've manipulated or mangled your name. Chicago Carnage returns on the attack. Ronnie Green with his eighth shot of the period. Ronnie Green has just been on fire deep down into the Chicago Carnage offensive zone as he took his eighth shot of the game, ladies and gentlemen. That was kicked out by goaltender Mark Meyer, and once again the Carnage now, with 2 minutes and 36 seconds left to play in this game, are going to slow the pace down and try and get the assault deep into their zone. Make a nice headman pass as we watch here as Dave Hines will tee it up. Boy, he got a lot of wood up it, and they hit the post. Ronnie Green went deep after Dave Hines took the slap shot, and Ronnie Green getting the rebound of a Hines shot hit the post as he had the goaltender beat. And now, great move to the outside as the Motor City Assault player who walked in alone, Kyle Sombrowski, wasn't touched by a Carnage player, was able to get a backhand on net. There's a hit. And once again, here we go as the Carnage are going to bring that puck up. Number nine, Brian Berman takes a shot. That's kicked aside by the defenseman as Colin Sipperly, number 21, will rush it up. I'll tell you what, moving, great speed, Sipperly picking up, great snapshot from the outside. Nobody there, unfortunately, to clean house for him as a frustrated Ronnie Green now allows a pass to go by him. And once again, the assault will maintain control. Bursting with speed out of his zone is Kyle Strombowski down the wing. Goes to the backhand. He's tripped. Looks like we have a penalty. And the Chicago Carnage will be shorthanded once again, ladies and gentlemen. As with a minute 13 left in our game, the Motor City Assault can call this a victory. They've had a pretty good afternoon. Looks like they're going to go, 2-0-1 on the day as they lost in overtime to the Buffalo Excitement earlier today. So the Motor City Assault will finish this event 2-0-1, and it looks like the Chicago Carnage is going to finish 1-2. And again, to the Carnage, it's difficult when your bench is short like that, and they didn't expect the injuries, but they came out to battle, and it's been a great afternoon of hockey for both teams. Carnage player will dump it all the way down. That was Dave Hines as he clears the puck. And now Motor City will just take that opportunity to slow the pace down and just burn the clock. Kyle Sipperly, brother of Colin Sipperly, in the high slot there as Ronnie Green misses his pass and misses the open man. There's a tic-tac-toe play. One too many passes as the Motor City Assault just can't get a handle on it. That puck is going to trickle back. And right now, number 22 brings the puck over the line, Ben James, which means that all the Assault players will have to clear the zone and will get a whistle. Your final score this evening, as the Motor City Assault will win 7 and the Chicago Carnage 2. I want to thank both teams for being and participating in our first event here in Novi, Michigan. We look forward to coming back in January, where Major League Roller Hockey will be hosting another event, and we expect the same four teams in our Atlantic East Division to be participating. Look forward to it. We're going to use this opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to take a commercial break. Once we return from our premier sponsors, we will bring you the second half of the evening and part of our doubleheader, as we'll see the Buffalo Excitement take on the New York Rockers in the battle for New York, and Kenny Van Sky, the general manager of the Chicago Carnage, will be my guest.
CMT10 Revolt, featuring a true vented tongue and an anti-sting lace bite insert. With airflow like this, your feet will always stay dry.
Dude, why'd you stop?
T10s are dry.
I don't think they're dry yet.
Come check out the Axiom T10 Revolt for yourself at the 2011 Finals.
Michigan. Doug Jones here, joined by Kenny Van Sky of the Chicago Carnage. And Kenny, as we talked about this afternoon, just a very, very difficult time for the Carnage tonight because of the fact that you had such a short bench. And one of the things that I admire is you came out, played a first game, you guys did a great job, and then ran into difficulty as the day went on. You had an injury to Eric Newell who went down with an ankle problem. And then after that, you guys did your best you could to go ahead and have the opportunity to play a very good Motor City Assault team. Tell me, what are some of the things that have really gone into you picking the team this year and putting together the crew that you have?
A lot of it has to do with whether or not they played ice hockey. I didn't want just a regular roller hockey experience. I wanted guys who knew how to hit, who knew how to take a hit, and you are going to go out there and get the guys, and get everybody out there excitement. So, obviously, you see my bench, there's some bigger guys. You know, the Buffalo team found that out. They were, you know, it was a little bit different playing them. But, you know, it's one thing that we lack in Chicago with the Roller Snakes. You know, the first two seasons I was on.
Absolutely, but you got to look at your goaltender. Jim Thompson, as I said, he came up, made some great saves. It was a 4-2 game, and Jim played like it was a nothing game. The guy never gave up. What can you say about Jimmy?
And there's not much you can say about him, other than, you know, he's been a stellar goaltender. He's based out of Wisconsin. He was born in Chicago, but he's played for State Wars for Wisconsin and all their top-tier teams. He's even backed up the Admirals at one time.
Wow, that's fantastic. Milwaukee Admirals of the International Hockey League. And in looking at that Carnage team, Ronnie Green, just watching Ronnie Green down low all the time. Magic hands, tries to get that puck, work a little magician trick there and score. I'll tell you, very impressed. Dave Hines, Brian Berman, definitely a good roster supporting cast. What can we expect from you at the next MLRH event, Kenny?
Well, one, you'll expect a few extra guys. You know, it was unfortunate we had some players that were out and they had to skate college tournaments this weekend, but we're set to go for the next one. And we're going to debut, not only as Thompson will be out there, but we'll have our new goalie, Christian Ricketts from Slippery Rock University out there.
There we go, and I've heard nothing but good things about this young man. But here's something great. You had mentioned State Wars. Right now, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take this opportunity to break from RollerHockeyTV.net as we're going to go live to Long Island, New York, with State Wars president and CEO Tim McManus, who's going to talk to us about State Wars 2012. Let's go to Tim.
Hey, everybody. Tim McManus, National Director of State Wars Hockey, bringing it to you straight today from State Wars HQ. As promised, I'm here to talk about 2012, some exciting things on the horizon for State Wars Hockey. First off, just want to thank everybody who participated in State Wars last August here, 2011. We had what I thought was one of our greatest events ever, our most competitive tournament probably to date. And we just want to thank everybody from the parents, the players, the coaches, the volunteers, the sponsors, everyone who was a part of that. And as we move forward here to 2012, State Wars 8, we plan on just making this event bigger and better as we continue to do each and every year. So please look for a lot of information coming out on our website, statewarshockey.com. You know, this March, as always, we have our two Winter Wars events, Winter Wars West back in RMR in Lakewood, Colorado, and a week later, Winter Wars East in the Sportsplex in Feasterville, Pennsylvania. For the last 4 years, those two events have been sold out, terrific events, the best in the areas at that time of year. So please make sure you you get your teams down there. Those events are open to any teams that want to come out as a team and play and represent their state or province in those tournaments. So please check out our website about that. And we're also excited to announce our first ever Midwest Wars event this April, coming to Detroit, Michigan. Going to be held at two facilities, the Joe Dumars Fieldhouse and at the new rink. A new facility just opened up and being run by Coach Z, one of our state directors out in Michigan. So we're excited to bring the Midwest Wars to that area and just kick off the roller hockey season in the Midwest. But of course, the big news, the reason why everyone's tuning in here, is to find out, where is State Wars 8 going to be held this summer? You know, we've searched long and hard to find the perfect facility for State Wars this year. You know, we've gone to some good facilities in the past, but we wanted to go to a great facility this year. We wanted to bring our family somewhere new. I know between all the major tournaments out there, we've seen the same places numerous times, it seems like, with all of us. And I wanted to go somewhere just brand new, somewhere fun, somewhere exciting, somewhere that many of you probably have never visited before. And I think we found that in Rock Springs, Wyoming. Just a great state. I fell in love the minute I got there. No, I'm teasing you. State Wars 8 will not be in Wyoming. And just give me 1 second, please. Sorry about that. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of you sitting there probably think you know where State Wars is going to be this summer. And, you know, it's exciting for us that you're excited. You know, when the baseball playoffs started this year, I said to Greg in the office, you know, Greg, whoever wins the World Series this year, that's where I want to go. You know, and we'll make that decision when the playoffs are over. And that's why it's taken so long to announce this, quite honestly. So, you know, it looked like we were going to be in Texas for a little bit. And, you know, when the playoffs started, I would have predicted Pennsylvania or maybe here in New York. But those St. Louis Cardinals, they shocked everybody. And because of that, and for no reason other than we found a beautiful facility in maybe one of the funnest and greatest hockey states in the country, we're going to be going to St. Louis, Missouri this summer to the St. Peter's Recplex. Yeah, you know, why the St. Peter's Recplex? I'm sure everyone has questions and everyone wants to know what's so great about this facility. And there will be tons of information on statewarshockey.com about the Recplex and about State Wars 8. But just real quickly, want to give us some highlights and some really cool aspects of the facility and the area. You know, there are three NHL-sized rinks in the facility. It's a two-building complex. There are three NHL-sized rinks. So you have full-size rinks, all of equal size. They're all concrete-based. We melt the ice, put our flooring right on top of the concrete, so there's really no chance and issues with condensation. All three rinks are fully air-conditioned individually, so we can keep the rinks really cold and comfortable for everybody on all three floors, which is great for staff, fans, players, everybody. The main arena has seating all around. They have upstairs balcony, downstairs, concession areas you could watch the games from in certain spots on that main rink. There are multiple concession areas that will be fully stocked this year. Bar areas, all that good stuff in the rinks. There is a nanatorium with a bunch of pools and water slides and diving boards and whatnot that will be open for the families to use, along with hot tubs, saunas, workout centers, all that kind of fun, cool stuff inside the facilities. There's tons to do outside of the building. There are two casinos 5 minutes from the rink. The airport is less than 15, 20 minutes tops from the rink. Downtown St. Louis is around 25 minutes from the facility, where you have tons to do. More casinos, the Anheuser-Busch Brewery, the Arch, St. Louis Cardinals games, St. Louis Museum, St. Louis Zoo, tons in the area. A lot for the kids, a lot for the families. Just a real fun, cost-effective area to go. Easy to get to from all around the country. Missouri, you can't get much more central in the country than Missouri. So it's a place that many can drive to, and those that have to fly can get there reasonably priced and in not too long of a flight. So it's just a perfect area for us. St. Louis has always been a hotbed for inline hockey, So I'm proud to bring the event back there and hopefully just give a shot in the arm to our sport out in that area. And I'm real excited. You know, you have even Lindenwood University, the best known roller hockey college team and program in the country, is right there in the St. Charles area where the facility is. We're working on setting up some tours with that college as well for the older guys and girls to go and check the school out. So again, we're just real excited to be going to St. Louis. I know those that know the area, that know the facility, are thrilled to be going somewhere new, somewhere fun, and just a real, real hockey town. So State Wars 8 is going to be a great one this year. We hope you're there. Make sure you register for tryouts. Tryouts start after the new year. Registration will begin at statewarshockey.com. We're already releasing our dates for all the state and provincial tryouts, so check those out online. And come January 1, make sure you get registered. Make sure you're there. State Wars 8 is going to be the best ever, and make sure you don't miss it.
All engine running.
We are back live here in Novi, Michigan, as the New York Rockers jumped out to a 2-0 lead on goals by Josh Johnston, and that was followed up by Pat Lilly, who scored on the power play. But the Buffalo excitement has just made it a 2-1 game as they've answered back, and we're going to wait for our PA announcer here to give us a goal. Doug Jones, Major League Roller Hockey Commissioner. I'm joined by Kenny Van Skye, who's going to be adding some colorful commentary to this. And we're going to pick up the play exactly where we left off. New York Rockers wearing jerseys that they just got today, actually. We got a kick out of the fact that the Rockers jerseys came in right before, actually, their first game. So they were pleasantly surprised to have everything here. Buffalo wearing the fluorescent green and black. Rockers wearing the Boston Bruin colors almost with red numbers of gold, black, and red. And here's Derek Seminelli, who works a little magician puck magic as he tried to whisk his way through center there. Seminelli now skating back, and the excitement will mishandle the puck as it falls and trickles loose, and now they'll break out on an even man attack as the defenseman jumps up into the play to give him a 3-on-2. That shot will get blocked, and the puck heads back as number 7, Greg Brick, who went off earlier for kneeing. And when Greg went off for kneeing, Pat Woolley of the Rockers would exact revenge by scoring that power play goal. We'll move it up as the excitement now try to go deep into their zone. It's broken up by Pat Woolley, our goal scorer, as he moves the puck over to Seminelli. Seminelli, who is playing out there wearing the Detroit Red Wing red and having the black helmet on, takes a shot that whisks over the top of the net. And now the excitement will come back and head towards their offensive zone. That puck will get picked off and stripped, but great play by the Buffalo defenseman as he'll rush in. And taking a shot from a bad angle for Buffalo was number 3, Kevin O'Connor, as he'll move that puck back. And O'Connor will regroup in his own zone.
I'll tell you what, you got to admire how the Buffalo moves the puck out there. I mean, they're doing quite well. It's really fun to watch.
As Kenny says, they don't call him the best color man in hockey for no reason, ladies and gentlemen. Buffalo does move the puck very well. They like to come in deep and then regroup or set up. What a move by O'Connor as he averted a check and he gets it up there. Oh, backhand attempt by number 19 for the excitement as he wasn't able to finish the play. And that was Brennan Friedman who got that puck there. There's a shot. What a save by the goaltender for the New York Rockers, Keith Chapman. Tees up, takes a point-blank shot to the chest, kicks out a rebound, and then follows up with another great save.
I'll tell you what, this Rockers goalie's been solid if you watch him the last two games. And it seems like he's getting better as he's playing today.
And again, the big key out here is goaltending, as we all know, as we get a whistle for a false start and a bad line change. Referee is now warning the New York Rocker bench to make sure they make their changes in a timely fashion. One of the big things today, this afternoon, is having an opportunity to watch all four of these teams play. What were your thoughts on that, Kenny, getting to see everybody?
Well, you know, it's good to come out here and watch the level play against the people you're competing against. But what's nice is I've skated against a lot of these competitors. And we look right there to hit. But, you know, the hitting's just been getting better and better as the games can play tonight.
That was a great play by the defenseman who, for the Buffalo Excitement, just absolutely stood up. That was a... If that was Nick Smolinski, that's what I thought. It wasn't Smolinski. Somebody wearing number 10 for him. But great play as he stood up. And, I mean, he just absolutely hit Adam Rudolph. Great save by the goaltender, Keith Chapman. Excuse me. I believe that's A.J. Zetville, unless I can't see my numbers correctly down here. He came up huge with a glove save. We'll get verification that that's Zetville starting in net as we get a face-off. To his right, the puck is controlled deep in the zone by Buffalo, who's going to try and once again regroup and make something happen. As Buffalo tries to move forward, we get a whistle. Two players collided. It looks like they locked knees with each other. And as they get up, and that's one of the great things I like to see. Guys know each other. It wasn't on purpose, so they get up, just look at each other, give each other a glove bump, and say, hey, I'm good.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough getting in the corners of some of those guys. But at least they're keeping it clean after the whistle.
That's one of the things we appreciate today here in Michigan is having the opportunity to watch some great hockey, some high-level speed hockey, and at the same time not having it being overwrought by any physicality or any cheap play. But all these teams have come out here and worked hard. The referees have done a decent job, so we're very happy to have our first successful event here in Michigan and look forward to our next one. Here's the New York Rockers with the puck. As Pat Woolley will rush it in and then cough it up. Here comes the excitement. Nice play by Pat Woolley as he strips the Buffalo forward of the puck as that was Kevin O'Connor going deep. O'Connor battling. One man wrecking crew out here. O'Connor right now as we're looking at a power play situation for the Rockers and the Buffalo Excitement playing shorthanded. There's a walking in, getting a shot, and that puck trickles through the legs of the goaltender, and it's waved off. And with Major League Roller Hockey, all the players on the power play must come out and tag the red line. And what were your thoughts about that rule, Kenny?
You know what? It's a nice rule because it stops that cherry picking down there at the end of the rink. It makes sure everybody gets back, so it's a fair chance. And, you know, to me, it's one of the best rules you guys have out there.
So, again, in keeping the players honest and not allowing the home run passers, we used to laugh about 10 years ago, as Jerry St. Cyr would say, who played with teams like Mission, Rink Rat, the old home run pass, James Jensen would throw it to the defenseman up to Jerry St. Cyr, who would have that breakaway and score. Major League Roller Hockey, you got to tag that red line or make sure that you carry that puck across the red line. And as the faceoff is, again, 28 seconds left, shot and a goal by the Rockers. As number 5 for New York, Jamie Aiken would bury the puck at the faceoff, and that's a power play goal. It's going to give the Rockers a 3-1 lead as Jamie Aiken once again has burned that marker past them.
I don't know if you watched the Rockers that first game, but they were playing without Derek Seminelli. And Seminelli's making a big difference out here with them over the last 2 games.
Derek Seminelli, as you know, plays both ice and in line. And had a little talk with him this afternoon. Derek next year wants to go to the Danbury Whalers of the Federal Hockey League's training camp. I told him if he works hard and he shows me what he's got, I'll be happy to make sure I call the GM personally, which is Phil Esposito on that team, and get him a tryout. Boy, Simonelli took me to heart.
I'll tell you what, that's for sure. And, you know, just throw out a name like Phil Esposito. I mean, obviously, me being a Chicago guy, I know the Blackhawks very well. I've known the Esposito family my whole life, and that's a class act out there.
Phil Esposito, as we know, Espo number 77, who was a Boston Bruin. Actually, he was originally a Chicago Blackhawk before he was a Boston Bruin. Set the record for 76 goals in a regular season, which was broken by Wayne Gretzky in the 1983 season. And that was a momentous occasion, as that was in Buffalo, New York. And Phil Esposito was there in person for that game to congratulate Wayne when he did break his record. And, of course, I think one of the things we'd agree upon is that the hockey in the 80s was not the hockey that it was in the 70s. For Phil Esposito to score 76 goals played against bigger, tougher. That was when the game down low, you paid the price when you were in front of that net.
That is for sure. You didn't have the room to go out there and skate like some of these guys do now. Not to mention the size of the nets, what the goaltenders are using. I mean, you really had a grind to get those goals.
Players were bigger. Back in the 70s, you were dealing with a lot of physicality, a lot of fighting. And the tough thing for players like Esposito was to have an opportunity down low without having somebody like a Moose DuPont or a Rick Chartrand draped all over you and trying to get the shot up. Nowadays, the players are bigger, stronger, faster. Today's NHL doesn't compare to the 70s NHL as far as what actually happened with the physicality and the way the game was played. So enough said about Phil Esposito here as we take a break with 30 seconds left in our first half. It's 3-1. As the New York Rockers have surprised the Buffalo excitement so far. And let's see what the excitement do with this opportunity. As again, excitement wearing the fluorescent green and black jersey. New York Rockers wearing the colors of the Boston Bruins with the black, gold, and red out here. Rockers maintain control as Jamie Aiken makes a nice pass. Looks like that puck was kicked over the line. Referee will wave off the offside because one of the excitement players had touched it. And with 3 seconds left, we're going to take this opportunity to conclude our first half again with the New York Rockers 3, the Buffalo Excitement 1. We'll be back in the Major League Roller Hockey Studios right after these commercial messages.
DJ Khaled! Hey! Yeah!
All I do is win, 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 no matter what. Got money on my mind, I can never get enough. And every time I step up in the building, everybody hands go up. And they stay there, and they say yeah, and they stay there. Cause all I do is win, win, win. And if you going in, put your hands in the air, make them stay there.
Ludacris going in on the verse, cause I've never been defeated and I won't stop now. Keep your hands up, get them in.
Back here at the Major League Roller Hockey Studios, Doug Jones, joined by the general manager of the Chicago Carnage, Kenny Van Sky. Kenny, what were your thoughts on that first half?
I'll tell you what, that first half, to see the Rockers come out and take that quick jump on them was impressive.
Well, again, the Rockers are surprise act of the day. I think when we watched their first game against you, a little lackadaisical, you guys took them down 4-1 in a game where you showed, had your bench not gotten tired or been that short, you would have definitely played that way through the remainder of the day. But as we saw on that 4-1 victory on your part, I looked at the Rockers and thought they were missing something. They just didn't have that ingredient. You seem to think it's Derek Simonelli.
I'll tell you what, Simonelli is definitely a wrecking to deal with out there. Skating against him for years, he's fast, he's smart, and he really knows what he does with his team. And he's had the advantage of playing with some of these guys in Narch. So,
Derek Simonelli making his debut this afternoon with the New York Rockers in two games. Played very, very well, very strong out there. Hard to knock off the puck. Low center of gravity, obviously making a big difference for the New York Rockers. It's 3-1 right now. We're going to pause for a commercial break, and then we'll be right back on the RollerHockeyTV.net network with the second half of the Buffalo Excitement and New York Rocker game.
as we come back to Novi, Michigan, ladies and gentlemen, I think we're cursed tonight because every time we take a commercial break, something exciting happens. Josh Johnson just got his second marker of the night, and he scored after Derek Simonelli was on the receiving end of a hit where a player, once again, using that knee. We don't like to see that out here, obviously. Very dangerous to any hockey player. But Derek Simonelli took a knee to the outside, and as he was trying to wrap around the defenseman, Johnston walked in and buried the puck. So the score is now Buffalo Excitement 1, the New York Rockers 4, and we are contributing again as the Excitement will rush that puck deep into the New York Rockers zone. Here come the Rockers on another attack. Oh, sidesteps a big hit as number 12 there, Josh Zerba, did a nice dance move around Kevin O'Connor, and now O'Connor exacts his revenge in the corner as he finishes his hit.
I'll tell you what, though, you're talking about the knee on knee hits, and that's something you've really got to pay good attention to. That's an easy way to start a career quit.
That's one of the things, again, we frown on, and we make sure that's an immediate call and a penalty in Major League Roller Hockey. As the Buffalo Excitement now is going to slow the game down. Smart move. If it's not working when you can't run and gun with somebody, there's nothing wrong with slowing that puck down and trying to make that first pass. As again, the Excitement now getting into trouble as they're in the New York Rockers zone. They're not able to do much with that puck as they're trying to set the play. And once again, Buffalo will make a line change as there he is. I'll tell you what, he reminds me, if you were to compare him to a Detroit Red Wing, Derek Simonelli, who would you compare him?
I'll tell you what, there's so many different weapons to go with, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to lost for words on this. I mean, I'm not one for obviously watching the Detroit games, but my best as far as a Detroit player would always be Cicerelli, but that's something that Derek's not exactly part of, so.
We remember Dino Cicerelli. I mean, 50 goals for the North Stars, and he played for the Red Wings. He had a lot of Washington Capitals. He had a great career. As we're talking, just Derek Simonelli walked around in front of the net, tried to pull a Michigan move, and ended up with Mike Vertino giving him a cross check to the back in just pure frustration that he even tried to do a Michigan. Here's Vertino walking in with the puck. Goes into the corner, tries to get a backhand off, but he was way too deep to get that shot even close on net.
I'll tell you what, the Rockers goalie, like I said, he has definitely gotten better and better at the skate. And he's just stolen that.
Here's Vertino with the puck as he's got a two-on-two rush. Once again, crossing the red line. Oh, he's tripped as one of the Rockers just took his skates out from under him. It wasn't even questionable.
Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you what, that's, again, something you definitely don't want to see.
And we're going to get a whistle and a face-off, but we're going to use this opportunity right now to pause for a commercial break. We'll be right back on RollerHockeyTV.net Network after these premier sponsor announcements.
This is Georgie Barber of AKS Mission Empire. He's really good. And this is the Hornet Split. Is there a doctor in the building? I'm definitely having a seizure right now. No, seriously, call one. The Hornet Split's going to grip better and last longer using our patented M-Tech technology. What's a dog doing in the video? Weird. Don't believe me? Ask AKS Mission Empire, NARCH Division 1 champions. Get on the Hornet Split today because you do not want to make this guy mad.
We are live again in Novi, Michigan, and if I've said the word live too many times, boy, do I apologize to our viewers. As we went to commercial, Corey Butts, number 32, took a tripping penalty, and then that was immediately followed by, while the Buffalo Excitement were on the power play, the New York Rockers, number 15, Josh Johnston, who has two goals on the night, then took another minor, and Buffalo very wisely called their timeout to stop the clock. So Buffalo will now have a two-man advantage for 1 minute and 16 seconds.
Well, I'll tell you what, that's tough. You're down three goals. You're already on a penalty kill. And then you do something like that. I mean, that's just something you got to discipline your guys. It can't happen.
And now Buffalo will take the time to set up as they move the puck around. Little puck movement there, tricky behind the net. Buffalo using the box system again. Not too many people this evening have set up in the diamond. It's always interesting to see how different people set up. Mission using the diamond. But watching here primarily in the Midwest, I've seen nothing but the box used. So it's always different how teams vary. There's a quick shot on net, which goes wide by Mike Fortino. That puck's kicked out. And Buffalo again will regroup in the corner, trying to get possession. As they do, Mike Benis will get the puck out to Fortino. He's not able to. And here's a break for the New York Rockers. Camilo Pros watching, takes a slash. There's no call by the official. And all the Buffalo Excitement players will tag up and bring the puck back. The officials wave, the players good, and they're able to bring the puck back in the zone. Again, had there not been that rule, we would have seen an immediate cherry-picking pass.
And that's for sure. Like I said, again, that rule is great, especially to make sure it's even levy play out there. And guys coming back and forth, it's a good thing.
Great call by the official as he whistles down an offside. So that'll kill the first penalty off with 48 seconds left on our second minor. And the faceoff will go deep into the Buffalo Excitement zone. Kenny, what do the Buffalo Excitement need to do right now to get this game turned around?
I'll tell you what, they need to hit these guys. And that's a problem. You see me, these Rockers are coming down and skating with being untouched. And they really need to start putting a body on them.
You're absolutely right. And that's one of the most important things is making sure that you finish your checks. Adam Ludoff will rag the puck in deep as they run the clock down. And Derek Simonelli coughs up the puck after he takes a little stick work by one of the Buffalo Excitement players. And now Kevin O'Connor will make a nice move at center and bring the puck over the red line. 7 seconds left on the power play. Shot. And again, as we would say, he buzzed the tower. A lot of players just love to come in and take that big, high snapshot, which you and I both know. If that puck doesn't hit the net, it's 2-on-1 the other way, because I think Kareem's around the boards and heads out, and you think they'd be a little more careful. We are back to even strength. It's 4-1 here as the New York Rockers are on top of the Buffalo Excitement. There's a costly turnover. Kevin O'Connor with an inside-outside move. Shot. Oh, and he hit the post. He had the goaltender beat clean.
Oh, my God. I can't. You know, that kid has been putting the puck in all night long. For him to miss something like that, I can tell you what. They got lucky on that one.
He turned the defenseman inside out with a great side-to-side move and then walked in, beat the goaltender, and then hit the post. I couldn't believe it. He had the whole net. There's a costly giveaway by Buffalo. And now, as the puck will hit the boards, it carooms over to Brendan Friedman. Friedman now will hit a pass to number 93, Dougie Gilmore. Number there, Mike Benis. Oh, what a move. And a great move. And we're going to have a hooking call on Benis as he tried to hook number 12, Josh Zerbel, off the puck. Zerbel, there a little animated action there, almost trying to sell the call to the referee. And the Academy Awards have already happened, but I'll tell you, he definitely saw that, and our referee will make the call, 2 minutes for hooking.
Yeah, again, you know, you're down there, you're grinding hard, and that's a costly penalty.
So with the New York Rockers preparing to go on the power play, 7:11 left in our second half. We hope you've been enjoying tonight our doubleheader as we watch the Chicago Carnage as a took on in our opening game tonight, the Motor City Assault. And right now, we're watching the Buffalo Excitement, who are wearing the fluorescent green and black, and the New York Rockers, who are in gold and black with red numbers as they play the second game of the evening. Here's New York on the power play, going deep into the zone as number 9 for the Rockers, Adam Ludoff. I don't know what he was thinking there. He just decided to take the shot. Nobody was set up or in position to support the puck. So he just figured, okay, I'm going to get it on net, force the goalie to freeze it, and we'll get a face-off.
Well, you know, the Rockers are sitting on top right now in this game, so, you know, they can take a few more chances. You know, Buffalo really needs to start digging deep and you know, winning those pucks, winning those battles on the board, so that's going to make a difference.
Absolutely, and as we know, the key to success is winning the little battles and making sure you maintain control of that puck. You don't have control of the puck, you can't win a hockey game. Rockers now bring the puck in, and it cleared again, so they'll all have to tag up on the red line. Players on the Rockers trying to find some room and space. Buffalo doing a little bit of a good job in clogging up that line, and once again, our referees make a great call on the offside, and we'll use that opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to give you another premier announcement from our sponsors as a part of Major League Roller Hockey. We'll be right back on the RollerHockeyTV.net network after these commercial messages. Michigan, we are joined by a very special guest as the puck has been cleared and the power play is now over. I have Daniela, who is with me, and Daniela was one of our very lucky participants tonight who got the shoot on Santa Claus. Daniela, did you score?
Yes.
You did, and what did you win?
A new hockey puck.
You got a brand new rocket puck by our sponsor, Rocket Puck, the official puck of Major League Roller Hockey. Now tell me the truth. Was Santa Claus a good goaltender? Would you put him on your hockey team?
Yeah.
You'd have Santa Claus be your goalie?
Yeah.
Do you think the Chicago Blackhawks would pick up Santa Claus and let him play goal?
Yeah.
You do, huh? Well, ladies and gentlemen, there you go. Daniela, daughter of Kenny Van Sky, says the new Chicago Blackhawks goaltender should be Santa Claus. I don't think there could be any better news than that tonight.
I'll tell you what, I know someone who's definitely got some good gifts when Santa Claus comes this Christmas.
Absolutely. Santa Claus takes care of all the good boys and girls, and boy, you earned it with that one. As we know, Santa Claus' save percentage, he lit in 5 out of 6. 6 shots, 5 goals. I think he's what, .100? Santa Claus, Daniela, that was awfully sweet of you to say Santa Claus should be the Blackhawks goaltender. I know if he would, Joe Quendo will really have his hair turn white.
You bet. Hair turned white, he probably wouldn't have any hair left.
Joe Quendo, a former New Jersey Devil and actual Colorado Rocky, New Jersey Devil, and Hartford Whaler. Now head coach of the Chicago Blackhawks, winning the Stanley Cup and having his first Stanley Cup win, as long as a very exciting, as we would say, the sport of hockey in Chicago once again rebirth and having the opportunity for fans to celebrate greatly in that town, seeing the Stanley Cup raised there. As we speak of Stanley Cups, Buffalo not having a cup, being to the final many times, but never being able to cross that finish line and take home the Stanley Cup. The excitement now, with control with 2 minutes and 39 seconds left, we'll try to gain what we call the zone as they move deep in, take another shot from a bad angle as Mike Vertino, again, will tee it up from the top of the circle but shoot it somewhat wide, making it easy for Keith Chapman to make the big save. And Jake LaFleur is the goaltender for the Buffalo Excitement tonight, wearing number 1 and being in net for them, doing a pretty good job out there. Not just a pretty good job, but facing some difficult shots as his defense has kind of left him alone and suspect. Buffalo Excitement will go in deep once again and try and get something going as they work a tic-tac-toe Russian hockey play. Each player touching the puck one time before they're able to get a shot on net. And now again, controlling it as they're on the power play. We got a little tie-up in front. Two players not happy with each other as they both fall to the floor and get into a pushing session. Now, number 10 of the Excitement is standing up and asking what's going on as he's going to go to the penalty box for pulling down number 19, Derek Simonelli.
I'll tell you what, again, there you go. There's an opportunity for Buffalo to get back in this game, and now now it's gone. You know, now you're back to 3-on-3, or you're skating 4-on-4 here, but you're out there with extra man.
A little bit of undisciplined play, which results in an opportunity of a power play now squashed, as we have 1 minute and 7 seconds left in the game. Buffalo would have control of the faceoff, but the Rockers gain puck control as they put a shot on net. And here goes Buffalo on the attack. A short-handed rush. Fenceman cutting down the side. Number 93. Oh, that puck trickled through the legs of Keith Chapman as number 93, Mike Benis, came down and got a great shot through the five hole that just trickled to the outside. And now it's all about a game of cat and mouse or puck control. Rockers are going to hold on to the puck as 35 seconds are on the clock. Minute 25 left in the power play for the Rockers. Buffalo excitement player gives away the puck in his own zone. And here comes, walking down the slot, is Derek Simonelli. Excuse me, that's not Simonelli, it's Josh Zerba. Players looking so similar out here, it's difficult for me to ascertain until I see their numbers. Josh Zerba and Derek Simonelli could actually be brothers. Here's a 2-on-0 for the Rockers. Great play in, shot. What a save by the goaltender as he comes up huge by taking that puck and knocking it away. And our final buzzer will go as tonight in Novi, Michigan, our doubleheader, we bring you a final score. It's the New York Rockers 4, the Buffalo Excitement 1. We'll be right back on the RollerHockeyTV.net network into our Major League Roller Hockey studios to close down the night right after these very important commercial announcements from our sponsors.
T10 Revolt, featuring a true vented tongue and an anti-sting lace bite insert. With airflow like this, your feet will always stay dry.
Dude, why'd you stop?
T10s are dry.
I don't think they're dry yet.
Come check out the Axiom T10 Revolt for yourself at the NARCS 2011 Finals.
Some great hockey played. The 2011 Midwest season opener, Kenny Van Skye, general manager, Chicago Carnage, Doug Jones wrapping up a great day. Four teams showed up here to compete this afternoon. In the beginning of the 2011-2012 season, we got to see the Chicago Carnage, Buffalo Excitement, the New York Rockers, and the Motor City Assault. And Kenny, your thoughts on how the day went?
I'll tell you what, it was a great opening weekend for us out here in the Midwest. I mean, it's nice to see MLRH back out here. The team's participating. We've been waiting for it for a while.
Got to hear from Tim McManus, who is live from New York. Tim, thank you so much for giving us that great information and the exclusive to Major League Roller Hockey, as Tim has announced the 2012 State Wars Championships this year will be in St. Louis, Missouri. And Tim McManus, if you haven't been to State Wars or done it, I was the state director for California for 2 years. I had a great time. This past 2 years, I've been the state director for South Carolina, where my wife and I live. Absolutely love it. State Wars is a great experience. I'm sure you've experienced it, Kenny.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody that has knows it's a first-class tournament. To find out more about State Wars, go to www.statewarshockey.com to find out when tryouts or any other events pertaining to State Wars, including their Winter Wars, which upcome in February and March, are going to happen. Let's talk a little bit about our first game this evening, as we got to watch two teams compete who both done an excellent job. We got to watch the Motor City Assault and the Chicago Carnage go head-to-head. And in a very difficult 6-2 loss, we watched the Carnage, who were a little bit with a short bench, do the best they could, but fall a little bit short.
Well, I'll tell you what, when you're out there hitting like my guys do, that takes a lot of stamina. And unfortunately, when you're a short bench with some injuries, it's going to affect your play.
And then the second game of the evening, watching the Buffalo Excitement, who I think you and I both thought would be the favorite in that game, coming up to the New York Rockers, who absolutely just soundly dominated that game from start to finish.
That's for sure.
It's a difficult situation when you come out and you expect the team to play a certain way and they surprise you. And I think the Rockers really surprised Buffalo.
I think the Rockers surprised everybody today. It was a really good outing for them in general.
Absolutely. And Andy Billheimer gets all the credit for putting that team together, bringing it into Major League Roller Hockey. We thank him for that. Great to have a presence in the Midwest. As we all know, the Midwest is a very difficult area to break into. The teams and the people that we've worked with at Major League Roller Hockey, we want to thank them for being so easy to deal with and making sure that everything is properly taken care of today. This has been one of the easiest days for me as far as paperwork goes and guys getting rosters and insurance in. Just an absolute great event day. Next weekend, December 10th, Major League Roller Hockey is coming to you live from Irvine, California, as number one Rob Laurie gets his jersey retired.
That's going to be an exciting night. I'll tell you what, I wish we had the opportunity to travel out that way, because we'd be there in a heartbeat.
Rob Laurie, as everybody knows, and we've been very, very happy to see on our Major League Roller Hockey. If you go to Facebook, search Major League, and you can join us as a friend on Facebook. But Rob Laurie has been garnishing a lot of just congratulatory and thank you for everything you've done mentions on the actual promotion for the game that night.
Yeah, like I said, it's always a special night when anybody gets something retired with their name on it. And I'll tell you what, he's been a stellar person in the whole industry in the league.
So. Rob Laurie again, number one, being raised to the rafters on December 10th. Bob Elder, former general manager of the Anaheim Bullfrogs and also recipient of 3 world championships with Laurie, will be there that night, as well as former teammate Joe Cook. And we're also expecting some more special guests. I look forward to that event, as once again, the Mission Axiom, undefeated. And with the hockey tonight in the Midwest, Kenny, you got to watch some of those Mission Axiom games. What do you think of that team?
I'll tell you what, they're so fast. I mean, they are so fast. And that's probably the biggest thing, is that it's one thing to get out there and skate with them, because you can have guys who can really put a body on people, but it's tough to put a body on somebody who's flying past you.
Absolutely. Mission Axiom has really proved once again they are the team to beat in Major League Roller Hockey. The Anaheim Bullfrogs have been trying to find their legs, but as we say, which Bullfrogs team is going to show up? The good Bullfrogs team or the mediocre team? We don't know. Hollywood Dream, Joaquin Chavera will be back in uniform, number 78, making his appearance again with the Hollywood Dream next weekend in Irvine. And also, don't count out the Arizona Arsenal. These guys are up and coming. Dan Maxwell on the bench. Rich Garvey, can't ask for any more. Chris Federigo with a hat trick last weekend, which was just absolutely, if you were there, that third goal he scored was just mind-bending. Well, on the backhand, underneath the crossbar. So the Arsenal will be competing with the Arsenal and the Bullfrogs will go head-to-head next weekend. And then we have the Mission Axiom and the Hollywood Dream wrapping up our return to Irvine on December 10th. First of all, the thank yous. We'd like to thank Jim Gorney here at Total Roller Hockey for this evening's event and allowing Major League Roller Hockey to be a part of the Michigan hockey community. We appreciate him bringing us into this building. We want to thank our teams that participated. Again, my thanks to Kenny Van Sky, general manager of the Chicago Carnage. I want to thank the Buffalo Excitement. Also want to thank the New York Rockers and the Motor City Assault for being here, participating, playing some great hockey. We'd like to thank our officials, who on a very short notice did a great job for us tonight and were able to interpret the rules correctly, which you and I know is a very big part of the game. And finally, we'd like to thank Bill Rowey, who is the president and owner of Major League Roller Hockey, to which all we know, none of this would be possible without his generous financing.
For sure.
We'd also like to thank Snow Trails Video and Mike Grant for his work once again, and Mike being able to continue to work with us and make sure that our productions keep getting better and better each time. Hopefully our fans and viewers have noticed that Major League Roller Hockey, from where we were last year to this year, has taken huge leaps and bounds. So we'll see you all next weekend, December 10th, 6 o'clock. Rob Laurie having his jersey retired live on rollerhockeytv.net. Ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy the rest of your weekend. All I have to say is, go New York Giants. And for Kenny Van Sky, general manager of the Chicago Carnage, myself, Doug Jones, Major League Commissioner, good night from Novi, Michigan.
December 10th, the full-hitting, hardcore action of Major League Roller Hockey returns to the rinks of Irvine as it's Rob Laurie night. And the Bullfrogs will retire Laurie's jersey in a pregame ceremony before they meet the ever-hot Arizona Arsenal, who have hit their stride and are challenging the Bullfrogs for second place in the Pacific Division. Game time is 6:15. Immediately following that game, the undefeated Mission Axiom and the Hollywood Dream. As the Dream look to hand Mission their first loss of the season, get your tickets at MLRH.com or AnaheimBullfrogs.com. December 10th, the full...